things we believe are important in our life, in our society, in our country. And I'm not kind of being bullied, not having a role model who thinks that that's a good way to be a role model, you know, by bullying. I think that's the strategies we're seeing in the head here. So I really just think human rights, as well as women's rights and medical care, all those things are really important. And just standing in a really good kind of a protest. I almost feel like I'm not protesting, I'm just standing in solidarity with people that really believe those things.
So I'm Amy Knisley. I work at Shenango Forks Central School District, and I'm their public relations person. Today I am marching not only for myself and my friends and fellow women, folks of varying communities, of races, religions, backgrounds, and upbringings. I march for my students. I march for those who need health care, who need a safe place to live. I march for those who are too afraid. I march for all of you. Thank you.
The worker who isn't paid a living wage. You, the woman who earns 20% less than your male co-worker doing the same job. You, the woman whose partner, lover, is another woman. You, the woman who were assigned male at birth. You, the senior who has no security in your senior years. You who has to make a personal choice about your body. You battling addiction. You who, because the color of your skin, are not afforded the opportunities that others are afforded. You who are living with physical and mental health concerns. Or elder abuse. You who, because of your religious beliefs, are shunned. You, because of the clothes you wear, are judged. You who came to this country hoping for a better life. You are future president. No woman left behind.
The Broome Tioga chapter of the NAACP joins its voice with citizen action in calling for the equality of the political, educational, social, and economic rights of all persons.
Our challenge. In order for policies that protect the lives and
We know this well here in New York State, the home of women's suffrage, where a small group of women, including some from Binghamton, New York, from the YWCA, traveled to Seneca for the Declaration of Sentiments and for that first women's rights convention. You know, it took 72 years, 72 years since that convention for America to give women the right to vote.
Wow.
72 years of struggle, 72 years of courage, 72 years of sacrifice. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come too far to go back now. This sash that the suffragists wore that says votes for women, this isn't just about accomplishing votes for women, this is about providing women votes right now. We need more women in the process because why? We have come too far.
Okay.
Pretty good, yeah. Pretty good. Just out here in solidarity with the women's march and everything.
As the translator, interpreter, and most closest to my heart, a job developer for the refugees in our community. All of the refugees who are settled in our area and live surrounding areas come to us, and we are helping them very diligently to find work so that they can contribute to our community and our economy. And we thank you very much for your continued support and love, and please continue to help us and our refugees and immigrants.
The divisive conversation that, and I use the word conversation lightly, that Donald Trump has utilized through his entire election, through his speech, is so disheartening, and I just want to unite and protect all my brothers and sisters. I don't care who you love, what color you are, who you pray to, what you do. We all need to love each other, support each other, and God bless America, is all I have to say. Because we've come here for a really important purpose today, and that purpose is to affirm our vision, a compassionate, inclusive, and resilient United States of America. Shared by civil rights activists who fight for and fought for equal representation without consideration for skin color or ethnicity. Americans, I have not been immune to the rhetoric spouted in today's society. Islamophobia has become apparent in threats and intimidation. I can't begin to tell you how many times I have been called a terrorist. I've been asked if Osama bin Laden was my uncle. I had a man stare me down at the gas station as I got gas next to him. He tailgated me to the highway from our gas station about a mile away. And every person has a duty to stand up and vote for the human justice.
Two was part of the conspiracy of women to make a safe space for Moses. They all stood together recognizing that defending the most marginalized among them could change the world. As an American, as a rabbi, and of course, as a human being, I affirm the integrity of every person as fellow human beings. Our prayers are in the form of action here today as we march together to affirm that women's rights are human rights. We are all hurting, oppressed, and threatened. I keep this in mind as I stand together in solidarity with our partners and children for the protection of our rights, our safety, our health, and our families, recognizing that our vibrant and diverse communities are the strength of our country. I condemn racism and hate in all of their manifestations, including Islamophobia, anti-Semitism, discrimination against people of color, LGBTQ, refugees, immigrants, Native Americans. And we cannot forget the assault on women to be in charge of our own lives and our own bodies.
As a business owner, it is not necessarily a good idea to express my political beliefs. In fact, it is better for me if you simply believe that I believe exactly what you believe. If I speak my mind, and I tend to, I am bound to say something that someone doesn't agree with and lose yet another customer. And yet, what I believe is not particularly radical. I believe in the old-fashioned American dream where you can work and pursue your goals, whether they be sports, arts, friendship, chasing down Pokemon, perhaps raise a family. I envision a world where we can all live together with mutual respect, without undue fear. But in the decades of standing in the middle, the world has drifted away from me, over to the right somewhere. I think some time ago, the American dream was hijacked, becoming a more selfish vision, where a handful of us can hit the metaphorical lottery and live like kings amidst the struggling multitudes. Rational historical arguments are a thing of the past. We're fighting a pack of wild beasts with words. We hope that we could find the perfect Facebook meme that would convince my right-wing friend Larry that he is wrong. But Larry has his own facts. Larry has his own network to watch to reinforce his worldview that is built on a foundation of self-referential lies. The monster we face is one all about power, and Trump is one. And if we wish to save the planet, we are losers. If we support women's rights, we are losers. If we want universal health care, we are losers. I am one of the losers who dream of a just world ruled not by fear, but justice and ideals. Donald Trump says no one respects women more than he does. I guess that is true in the same way no one respects cattle more than a butcher. Celebrity hands to grab women's issues and make everything great again. And with climate change, one would think that putting a climate change denier in charge of the EPA does not bode well. But I'm sure Trump has a secret plan for saving the planet. Perhaps he's going to ruin it so survivors can get a good deal on buying up what's left. I can go on listing the foreseeable problems, but being rational in the face of irrationality will drive you crazy. And the other side is simply not listening. They dismiss us as sore losers or some other generalization that eliminates the need to be heard. Every word is silenced by the math of the Electoral College. But as much as they wish us to all shut up, there is one thing we ultimately have on our side, and that is real power that cannot be silenced. Individually, we're all some sort of minority like snowflakes, each one unique and small. But together, snowflakes make avalanches. Together, snowflakes cover a lot of ground. Divided over petty differences, we are easily defeated. United in our mutual concern for a better world for everyone, we are much stronger. And that is power that will ultimately save us and save our planet. Thank you for listening.
We want clean air, we want clean water, and we want clean land. The indigenous tribes, because if we keep our lands and our air and our waters clean, that all comes down to you as well. And that's a responsibility we all have, because as an indigenous person, we like to think of the next seven generations. In the next seven generations, how will this decision affect them? Will it benefit them? That's what we like to think of. So when we do go forward with laws and talking with these corporations and stuff, we really need to sit and think about what's gonna happen in the future.
I wanna share just some lines from a poem I'm working on to honor John Lewis. And I thought that you all might appreciate it. It's a work in progress. I'm entitling it, "I Will Walk the Bridge with You." And one of the lines says, "The bridge brings bats and blood and hate and steel to bear upon the mass. But hope and love shall keep the pace till we are free at last."
Do not ever let someone justify some disgusting comment from a guy by saying it's just boys being boys, or it's just guys being guys. There is no such thing. That excuses nothing. Maybe there's pervs being pervs. I don't know. But now we have a president who is normalizing this sort of behavior. A president who casually says he likes to grab women inappropriately without their permission, and when called out, excuses it for locker room talk. We have a president who responded to a study which found that 26,000 sexual assaults in the military have gone unreported by saying, and I quote, "What did these geniuses expect when they put men and women together?" What sort of barbarian outlook on our world is that? Our president is consciously normalizing rape culture, and the entire world is watching. But we're watching too. It's scary because as I was growing up and becoming an adult, I really looked up to President Obama. He was my role model. I wanted to be like him. I wanted to talk like him, act like him. I felt inspired to be a better man because of my president. I often wonder how I would have turned out if Donald Trump had been my president during those years. I am really worried for the young 13-year-old boys who are just like me and will wake up every single morning to a different degrading tweet from President Trump, a different racist remark, another vile comment bashing his dissenters. This man is our role model? No. But I have hope too, because we will find new inspiration in each other. Look around you. Look around you at all of these inspiring people, these fighters, these leaders. This is what our country is. This is who we are fighting for. I want to swear to you that I will continue to uphold the rights and fight for the rights of every single citizen of this city as your councilman, because I'm telling you, not everyone in City Hall is doing that. But there's only so much I can do, because as men have worked for thousands of years to destroy our world, it will be women who save it.
I don't trust Trump, and I don't trust the people that he's appointing in office at all. He's talking about draining the swamp. All he did was refill it with worse people than were there before.
We are angry at a president and a Congress that are salivating over the opportunities they now believe they have to repeal the Affordable Care Act, privatize Social Security, mess around with Medicare, defund Medicaid and Planned Parenthood, privatize public education, and throw away all of our environmental laws and regulations. We are angry. We are angry with a president that discriminates against a person because of the religion they practice, or because they look different than him. We are angry. And we need your help. I'm asking the ladies, the women here today, to please think about running for office. We will protect our rights. Please think about it. But there are other ways that you can help. You can make phone calls to your congressional representative, voicing your objections. Volunteer an hour to make telephone calls to spread the word. Knock on your neighbor's doors and tell them about a political candidate that shares our values. Show up and offer your help at events such as this to show your support. That I do not remember a time when I couldn't make my own decisions regarding my medical and reproductive health. I want my daughter, and I want all of your daughters, to be able to say exactly the same thing. Thank you.
Are you scared about what the future brings?
Yeah. You?
No.
You're not?
You're not? Okay.
Things are not getting worse. They're getting exposed. Yes, I know that's an oversimplification, but it is true. And part of our job here today is to keep things exposed and talk about and build alternatives. Alternatives, old and new. We must stop the gutting of Social Security, Medicaid, Medicare, Obamacare, and improve them. We need to protect the vulnerable from those who would operate in this manic culture to gaslight us into thinking that we cannot add two and two and come up with four. Defending ourselves is necessary, but it is not enough. There is an elephant in the room that must be addressed. The military-industrial complex and our addiction to war. John McCain wants to raise the Pentagon budget next year from $611 billion to $640 billion. In a bipartisan effort, Democrats and Republicans have over the last seven decades spent at least $14 trillion that could easily have been better used almost anywhere else. The government wants to spend $1 trillion over the next 30 years on our nuclear arsenal, our weapons of mass destruction. And drone warfare, as Leon Panetta said, is the only game in town. War is terrorism with a bigger budget. Breaking into the vault, as they did yesterday, watch out. We are all under the gun now. The arrogance of the idea that America is the exceptional, indispensable nation entitled to own and rule the world is appalling and brutal. The brutality of our sons and daughters, brothers and sisters, kicking in doors in the middle of the night in Iraq, dropping over 26,000 bombs by drones and otherwise in 2016 alone, and not doing enough to address PTSD and moral damage, and 22 soldier and veteran suicides per day, must end.
Primary care is a necessity for all. Repeal of the ACA causes the most vulnerable to once again be cast aside. Defunding family planning limits necessary access and removes safety nets. The GOP options are not options. Allowing states to choose how they provide health care to their people results in more expensive and limited care. We face a new worry, people. Those that fought the hardest to reject basic health care rights for all people when we first started ACA, when Obamacare first was being debated, these people now are seeking to repeal it. Women, men, you will see less care. Children will see less care if we repeal the ACA. For women, it's a double punishment. Because again, not only would a repeal to ACA be a problem, but then they want to defund Planned Parenthood. Go figure. Yeah. I stand with Planned Parenthood, family planning, and I stand with the ACA. I say to you, Senator Paul Rand, who believes that pregnancy care is too expensive, that pregnancy care is priceless, an investment in the people of this nation. When Senator Ryan suggests that young people go without health care because, according to him, they don't need it, I will answer you, Senator Ryan, I will not turn my back on those children in need, and neither should you. My friends, there is a great lady who stands in New York Harbor. Let us remember the words engraved there. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Florence Nightingale lifted her lamp. Clara Barton would not be silenced in the wake of great catastrophes. I will lift my light upon that billionaire's door. Do not let anyone dictate to us how our health care will be. Demand ACA, demand enhancement, and do not turn away those in need. People, thank you for staying here and listening to this. I ask you now, tell your stories to your congresspeople. Tell your stories to Mr. Trump. On their emails. Write your letters. I will not turn my back on my neighbor, my family, my friends, my patients. I will not turn my back on people of any gender, however you view yourself. Equitable health care is needed for all people, all of us. And I will not turn my back on people who don't agree with me, but I will seek to educate them. Thank you.